It's Diwali, Hindu festival of light. I'm in Jaigaon, an Indian border town. The streets are full of lights. Every shop has its own firework display. Kids are dancing round Catherine wheels in the road. I wander the streets with my camera. Suddenly, there in front of me is the famous gate, the entrance to Bhutan. I've looked forward to visiting this country for so long. Tomorrow, I shall go through that gate. Bhutan, land of the Thunder Dragon, is no ordinary place. It was closed to the outside world till 1974. The Bhutanese people believed that a Thunder Dragon protected their country from trespassers and evil spirits. This is the country where men wear the traditional tunic to work. Women are elegant in their kiras, where giant protective phallic symbols are painted on the walls of houses. The rice is red. And chilies are not just an ingredient, but the entire dish. Emma Datse, green or red chilies in a cheese sauce, definitely an acquired taste. There are fantastic monasteries. Incredible dzongs or fortresses. Far and wide you can hear the melodic tinkling of prayer wheels. And prayer flags are everywhere. Strung across bridges and clustered on hilltops. I learn that they are in five colours, blue, green, red, yellow and white, symbolising, amongst other things, the elements of water, wood, fire, earth and iron. Bhutan is well known to stamp collectors. These first day covers show some of the national symbols. The national flower is the beautiful blue poppy. The national bird is the raven. And the national animal is the takin, a strange beast with the body of a cow and the head of a goat. When the great Saint Lama Drukpa Kunli, also known as the Divine Madman, visited Bhutan in the 15th century, the people demanded a miracle. He asked for a whole cow and a goat for lunch. He devoured these with relish, and after a large burp, he took the goat's head and stuck it onto the bones of the cow. He commanded the strange beast to rise, and to the amazement of the people, the animal stood up and ran up to the meadows to graze. The national sport is archery. The rules are impenetrable. The targets barely visible. and bows extremely high tech. Competitions are great fun. Each team sings and dances to encourage their members, while hurling insults at their opponents to put them off. Getting to Bhutan isn't that easy. You can fly into Paro, the world's prettiest airport, or drive as we did, weaving and wobbling through the mountains on roads with frequent mudslides to Thimphu, the only capital in the world with no traffic lights. Old and new sit comfortably side by side. The traditional architectural style can be seen everywhere. Not just in the tsongs and monasteries, but in the houses and shops. And even at the petrol stations. Children know their traditional songs, stories, and dances. Many are trained in the traditional crafts, spinning and weaving. Wood carving and turning. Pottery and ceramics. Paper making. And metalwork. One of the highlights of my visit was climbing the rocky path to the Takshangomba, miraculously perched high up on the side of a sheer cliff, 3,000 feet above the Paro Valley. There are three ways of getting there: on foot, on horseback, or fly on the back of a magic tiger. It was Guru Rinpoche who introduced Buddhism to Bhutan in the 8th century. He was given the task of subduing the local demon, which he did by flying to the cave where he dwelt on the back of a tigress. The site became a place of pilgrimage, and a monastery was built in 1692, anchored to the cliff, they say, by the hairs of angels. The name Takshang means tiger's nest, and high up here, the only sounds to be heard are those of wind and water and the chanting of monks. After a few days though, we've seen so many temples and monasteries that it's getting hard to remember which is which, especially as photography isn't permitted inside. Three of us, all keen photographers, decide to jump ship. We just want to meet some ordinary people. We walk along the river. A couple are doing their washing. Some children are playing in the street. Others are doing their homework on the grass. And there are some very young cowherders. An old woman goes over a field gleaning the grain. In the distance, we see something happening. The harvest is in full swing. Students have obviously come home to help with the threshing. We have very little common language. They speak no English, and we only know a few words of Bhutanese. But we get drawn into the group. Eventually, the women gang up on us, and we have to earn our keep. We take turns in winnowing the grain. It's great fun. We were lucky to be in Bhutan to see the preparations for the coronation of the new king, at 29, the world's youngest monarch. He's the fifth in a line of kings who have overseen the modernization of the country, while strongly maintaining its independence and traditional Tibetan-style culture. In 2008, the country became a democratic constitutional monarchy, a process set in train by the fourth king, who introduced the policy of gross national happiness. This isn't just a cliche, but a set of explicit criteria to measure development projects and progress in terms of society's greater good. In Bhutan, gross national happiness is considered more important than gross national product. It's this that makes Bhutan the last remaining great Himalayan kingdom, the last Shangri-La.